In My Mind, created by artist Andrea Kowch. It is acrylic on canvas and 36 by 48 inches. Kowch is 35 years old and a full-time painter, as well as an adjunct professor at the College for Creative Studies in Detroit, Michigan. She has been winning numerous awards since she was just 17 years old. Let's begin by discussing the concepts of intensity, complexity, and unity in the work by explaining how Kowch has painted some elements of the painting using the rules of design organization to transmit these concepts. First thing that jumps out at me that adds to the intensity of the work is the atmosphere. The intensity of the atmosphere is increased by the emotional impact the work has on the viewer. The atmosphere is created by two conflicted figures with three pigs complementing the scene, with a storm in the distance and a barn catching on fire. Okay, let's dissect the painting. So as I mentioned, in the middle ground, we see two figures. A man is on the left side in a dynamic pose. So we see the Baroque diagonal from his hand to his suspender strap going up his back, down his right arm, and up again towards his hat. His face is hidden from view and looking away from the viewer. The next thing we look at is the woman on the right, at the circle of her pale moon face and the expression on it. Her face is ever so slightly turned towards him, but her eyes are looking to the sinister left. This causes a psychological tension between the two figures and makes us wonder what is going on between the two of them. Kowch never tells the viewers what the narrative is in her paintings. She leaves it up to the viewer to discern what's going on. The work is full of vitality, which also makes it intense. The painting is not insipid, but rather forceful and vivid due to Kowch's use of the rule of movement. So over here, we can see the flowing wheat going up his pant leg over here, the flame from the candle streaming into the pie and flowing out the apron strings. This flow of movement causes the viewer to see that things are being stirred up in the painting. The top of the painting has the complementary movement. Our eye swoops along the valley, pulls up a sinister angle along the storm columns, swirls about in the sky, and then our eye follows the Baroque diagonal of the land in the negative space created by the man's bent arm. And then our eye follows her hair whipping into the wind and comes out of the right upper top corner. Now her hair is also on the Baroque angle over here. And so is the edge of the land. That's on the Baroque angle. This painting's intensity is also achieved by Kowch's skillful rendering of form and light and textures in a realistic way, adding to the beauty of the work. The painting is complex as well as there are three pigs forming an S-curve of anxiety and two humans. We have one large door behind her as a compositional device to divide the picture plane, and we see 1/7 of the edge of the door over here, or 1/15 of the painting, and then we see this large chunk of the door take up a good space on the picture plane. So as you can see, these separations of distance are not equidistant. And then we also notice the rule of threes, the rule of thirds within the furniture. So we have one fat piece of the chair, and then we have these thin ones. So they're going in threes. And we also have it repeated over here in a very subtle way, the three slats of the window pane. Kowch also employs the rule of thirds, adding to the inner logic and structure, thus creating complexity within the painting. At the bottom, so I'll just show you on the armature what that looks like. So on the bottom, at the bottom, we have the back of the chair, his triangle legs, the candle, and her lower body, as well as the antique silver set holding the bottle of vinegar and oil, as well as salt and pepper. In the middle row, we have the two torsos, and at the top, we have the barn on fire, his head and her head on a figure-ground relationship on top of the door. Next is the rule of aspective view, as well as the figure-ground relationship. The man's body is outlined against the background, against this pale wheat background, and his yellow hat contrasts with the complementary blue and gray inside the storm clouds. Her figure is contrasting with the wood behind her, separating the figure from the ground. We also see the rule of repetitions at play here. The tornado's core is balanced by the V of his neck. So we see a triangle shape over here. We see a triangle shape over here in the negative space of where his face and arm are meeting. We see that again split by a smaller triangle. We see this tiny sliver of a triangle over here. We see a triangle of his suspenders over here, as well as of his arm. and this negative space between his arm and his back. We also see kind of like a triangular shape separating the two figures. We see the triangular shape of his pant legs. We also have a ton of pictorial thrust going on here. The tornado, the swoop of the land, his hat, his arm, and the other arm, and the suspenders, and his legs going in a moving triangle, as well as her hair over here on the Baroque diagonal, the apron strings, and her shoulders dividing the picture plane. Lastly, what makes the work complex and unified is the rich variety of contrasts, as well as the subtlety and imagination with which the work was painted. We see contrasts such as the colors of the painting, that tomato, the pink pigs, these two over here, contrasting with the bluish green one, the tertiary colors of her apron, yellow and orange, against a green shirt, the yellow wax candle contrasting with the pitch black pant leg. We also see the rule of enclosure heightening the drama within the work. Now, Clement Greenberg, who insisted art is for itself, that it doesn't need to be more than an idea without function, would be outraged by this narrative painting because it's an idea with a distinct function to tell a story. He would probably dismiss it as illustration, but is it? It's not selling a product. It's not pop art, all about reinterpreting consumerism, but rather detached from all of that. The painting focuses on the life, experience, and limitations of this woman in a contemporary relationship. The image is almost like a photograph. To quote John Baldessari, for most of us, photograph stands for truth. But a good artist can make a harder truth by manipulating the truth so easily by the way I juxtapose opposites or crop the image or take it out of context. When two forces contend in a photograph, I may favor one side or the other, the rider or the horse, for example, the upright mummy in its coffin, or the woman standing next to it in awe. Cropping can make the outcome of a struggle ambiguous. Okay, so that's the end of his quote. So this is what we see in Kowch's painting, two forces, two people contending with one another and their struggle remaining ambiguous. To quote from Kowch's website, the stories and inspiration behind her painting stem from life's emotions and experiences, resulting in narrative allegorical imagery that illustrates the parallels between human experience and the mysteries of the natural world. The lonely, desolate American landscape encompassing the painting's subjects serves as an exploration of nature's sacredness and a reflection of the human soul, symbolizing all things powerful, fragile, and eternal. Real yet dreamlike scenarios transform personal ideas into universal metaphors for the human condition, all retaining a sense of vagueness to encourage dialogue between art and viewer. So most of all, the overall impact of the work is powerful because we, the viewer, are left to imagine a scenario that we don't have the answers for.